नमस्कार दोस्तों, आज की कहानी है टाइगर प्रिंसेस ऑफ इंडिया डॉक्टर लतिका नाथ की, जो एक फेमस कंजर्वेशन इकोलॉजिस्ट एंड वाइल्ड लाइफ फोटोग्राफर है। शी इज एन इंडिपेंडेंट कंसल्टेंट ऑन वाइल्ड लाइफ इशूज। डॉक्टर लतिका नाथ की लाइफ की पूरी कहानी आज हम इनकी अपनी जुबानी सुनेंगे। एक और जिंदगी के वो संघर्ष भरे दिन, तो वहीं दूसरी ओर मानव वन्यजीव संघर्ष के खिलाफ आखिर कैसे निरंतर इन्होंने काम किया, कई लड़ाइयां भी लड़ी और ये मुकाम पाया। तो ये सारे किस्से आज इनकी जुबानी ही अपने शब्दों में ये बयां करेंगी। दोस्तों, हर कहानी की तरह इस कहानी में भी बहुत कुछ खास और दिलचस्प है। आइए आपको बताते हैं कि आखिर क्या कहती है हमारी आज की ये कहानी। दोस्तों, आपको बता दें, डॉक्टर लतिका नाथ वन्यजीव संरक्षण के बारे में अपने वैकल्पिक विचारों के लिए जानी जाती हैं। इनके पिता ऑल इंडिया इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ मेडिकल साइंसेज में डायरेक्टर के पद से सेवानिवृत्त हुए। वो वन्यजीव संरक्षण पर भारत सरकार के सलाहकार भी थे और 19 सालों तक भारतीय वन्यजीव बोर्ड में सचिव रहे। डॉक्टर लतिका नाथ ने अपना बचपन जंगलों और जानवरों के बीच बिताया और बहुत पहले ही एक इकोलॉजिस्ट एंड कंजर्वेशनिस्ट बनने का फैसला कर लिया। बड़ी होने पर भी ये अपने फैसले पर अडिग रही। फिर उन्होंने टाइगर्स पर रिसर्च करना शुरू किया। शी वॉज द फर्स्ट वुमन टू एंटर अ मेल डोमिनेटेड डोमेन, सो इट वॉज अ टफ फाइट फॉर हर। इन्होंने बाघ जनगणना की तत्कालीन प्रचलित प्रणाली को चुनौती दे दी। सरकारी विभागों की स्थिति को ये अच्छी तरह भांप चुकी थी। ऐसे में इंडिपेंडेंटली, जी हाँ, स्वतंत्र रूप से काम करने का इन्होंने फैसला किया और अपना ध्यान आदिवासियों पर केंद्रित किया, जिन्हें ये वन्य जीवों के सच्चे रक्षक मानती है। सोशल मीडिया पर अपनी वाइल्ड लाइफ फोटोग्राफ शेयर की और लोगों का भी इन्हें बहुत अच्छा रिस्पॉन्स मिला। शी थिंक्स एवरी फोटो हैज इट्स ओन स्टोरी एंड अ मैसेज। दोस्तों, ये एक ऑथर है जो एनिमल्स के बारे में उनके साथ अपनी खूबसूरत मुलाकात के बारे में अक्सर लिखा करती है। ये पोर्ट्रेट, फूड फोटोग्राफी, लैंडस्केप फोटोग्राफी, हर तरह की फोटोग्राफी करती है और फोटोग्राफी के अलावा भी काफी कुछ करना इन्हें पसंद है। जी हाँ दोस्तों, तो अब आइए सीधा मिलते हैं इनसे और इनके व्यक्तिगत और पेशेवर जीवन से जुड़ी इनकी ये कहानी सुनते हैं, सिर्फ और सिर्फ इनकी जुबानी।
Hi, my name is Dr. Latika Nath. I'm a conservation ecologist and photographer. I work as an independent consultant on human wildlife issues. I was born in Delhi at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, where my father was a doctor. We lived there for many, many years until he retired as director. My father had a second hat, which was an advisor to the government of India on wildlife conservation. He was personally very close to Mrs. Indira Gandhi, and he was the secretary of the Board of Wildlife when she was the head of the Board of Wildlife. And he was there for 19 years. So when I grew up, I pretty much knew only doctors or wildlife conservationists. So I always knew of this world, and that was the world that fascinated me. As an only child, I spent much of my time with animals and decided very early on that I wanted to be an ecologist. This was around the age of 6 or 7, I think, my mother tells me. So I never changed my mind, and that's what I always wanted to do. My grandparents lived in Kashmir, so I always thought that I would study the snow leopard and the hangul in the Chigam National Park. But terrorists hit Kashmir in the 90s, and we were one of the first families to get targeted by the terrorists. My grandparents' home was bombed using incendiary bombs. 7 of our staff were killed, and it became impossible for me to continue my work with wildlife in the state. I then had to look for something new to do, and I met Dr. H.S. Pawar, who was the director of the Wildlife Institute. And he threw the gauntlet at me, saying, nobody's managed to do any research on the tiger, and would you be able to take up the challenge, and are you up to it? And of course, there was no looking back, and the rest is history. So it's been a very tough fight to get to where I'm getting. I was one of the first few women in the field, and at that time, just to enter a male-dominated field meant that I go up against a whole horde of very powerful men. And I refused to enter any clique or be put into any box. I wanted to be me. I wanted to be acknowledged as a scientist who was unafraid to ask questions, however uncomfortable it might be. If this meant challenging the then system of counting tigers, so be it. If you look at my thesis, which was written between the years 1996 and 2000, which is way back, I questioned the census techniques used for tiger conservation and talked about the use of camera traps at that time, and also discussed that we need to use camera traps differently, and that extrapolation of data was not something that you could do to tigers, because there's no standard formula for tigers to be spread across a landscape. Every situation is unique. These are all issues that make people very uncomfortable. Policy and decision makers weren't ready to take notice of what was going on. And people on the board never really acknowledged the work that I had done. 20 years later, when I go back and look at it, they have implemented almost every recommendation of mine in my thesis, but they've done it 20 years later because they've come to the conclusion 20 years later. They could have just looked at my thesis at that time and begun work on it, but they chose not to do that. I, of course, didn't work in the government. I worked as a private consultant because there was a lot of people who wanted to ensure that I didn't raise my voice and ask the questions that I was asking. So I chose in the end, instead of spending my energies on fighting this, I chose in the end to work very quietly in the field, not work in a big organization, but work at the grassroots level with the tribal people, with the communities who are the true protectors of the wild, and chose to work my way from there. So I did my own work all alone without a huge organization or a group behind me. But it also meant that even if I did a little thing, it was a little thing that changed a life or made a difference. Because there was, you know, every rupee that was put into it was put in and went for what it was put for. It wasn't taken off for organizational costs or for paying people's salaries, because there was no such thing. And at the same time, because I wanted to live and work in the field, I realized that it was important to also touch upon the field of tourism. So I created a wildlife lodge, which was a fantastic journey in itself and a lot of learning from me. And I got to bridge the gap between the scientists, the park, and the tourism field. But there are not too many of us who are in a position to be able to do that. Somewhere along the journey, I started sharing my photographs, and I realized that people really enjoyed my photography. Very recently, have become involved in photography professionally. So now I don't write just conservation ecologist, I also write conservation photographer. But every photograph I take is a story. It has a meaning, it has a message. And that's the difference between just normal portrait photography and conservation photography. So that's really my journey. So I always write, if you look at my writings, I write about meeting animals. I'm also an animal communicator. People meet this with a little bit of skepticism, but it's true, it does happen. And I always talk about the fact that I go out into the field to meet an animal. And it's always a two-way interaction, and it's a very special interaction. And it could be anything. It's not just about a big tiger or an elephant, but it can also be a bird or an insect or a snake or a reptile. It could be anything. And there are many, many incidents where they leave a very strong impact in your mind because of what you experience with them. But I think For me, it's also about meeting trees, going into forests, being in the mountains, sitting on the side of a, you know, on a beach near the ocean, watching the bioluminescence coming and going. These things change you. If you ask me about the incidents that changed me and changed my life, I mean, any meeting with an elephant is incredible. Okay, and elephants are just the most wise, amazing, wonderful, caring creatures that you can come across. So all the master's work that I did, which was on elephants, started this love affair with elephants, which has never stopped. Also, I had tigers when I was doing my doctorate that I had a one-to-one relationship with, which was really, really special. There was a tiger called Charger that I was very fond of. More recently, I swam with the whale sharks, and that was just the most unbelievable experience, because to be in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, in the blue with two sharks, one on your left, one on your right, and you know, you're just so out of your depth because you're in this strange environment, and they're so in their space. And then, you know, one of them was like 16 meters long, which is like, you know, a few buses. It was just unbelievable. But then equally much, I was in Kenya and I walked on foot with a pack of wild dogs, you know, the Kenyan painted hunting dogs. And they're considered some of the most fierce predators of the world. And to be with them, to watch them make a kill, to be face to face, to smell their breath, to have one sitting 3 feet away from you, and you're there without protection. You're not carrying a gun or a weapon. There's nobody with an arm next to you. You're just sitting on the floor still with your camera. Your only movement is your camera. And they come and they accept you. And you're in the middle of the pack. And it's amazing. You know, there are times when you stop breathing. So I was sitting with this pack of wild dogs in the middle of the bush, watching them play with something. And there was this ruckus and they all got up and I didn't know what had happened because I was right down on the ground, literally lying on the ground with a little beanbag and my camera on that. And what I didn't know is that there was a wild elephant standing right behind me. And if he had come a few feet forward, he would have been walking over me. And the dogs were reacting to him and pushing him back. And, you know, and then I turned around and I got these pictures of these dogs with this elephant and, you know, showing him off. But that was really a close escape. And it's beautiful the way the dogs looked over me and saw the elephant and actually went out there to prevent him from coming on. So, you know, these are things that you just never, ever forget. It's just so special. Okay, I don't know about my greatest achievements or accomplishments. I still feel I'm just starting. I have so much more to do. I feel that if I had more support and I had a more backing, there's just so much more I could do for India. I'm still searching for a platform and some support from the government and the political organizations to allow me a voice, because I have a lot to say and I have a lot to share, but I feel that I've just not been given the opportunity. It's just a beginning. I think only now, with time, with experience, you begin to understand the magnitude of the problem and what needs to be done. So I think the fact that people like you are coming out to talk to me and allowing my voice to be heard is one of my greatest accomplishments, because I've done it through my work. I've not done it because I belong to a privileged background or family. It's acknowledgement for the fact that I'm an honest worker and I'm really worked. And I think that is my biggest accomplishment till date. When I was traveling around the world, I realized that the problems and the issues and the people are pretty much the same across the planet. It's not something that's different from different countries. It's more about the leadership than the actual people. If you go down into the grassroots, people are the same everywhere. Everywhere people need food, they need to make money, they need to educate their children, they need healthcare. It's pretty much the same everywhere. It's not about the fact that in India it's like this or in Kenya it's like that. It's not that. It's the same everywhere. And everywhere, it's the political leadership and the governments that change the way people think of conservation. So that is what is different. I mean, if you look at Bhutan today, look at the way the kings of Bhutan have led the people into this beautiful, sustainable lifestyle. And this is the leadership that talks. And if you go into the tribes of Ethiopia or Kenya, if you go to South America, you realize that the issues are the same. They might have little details that are different, but the issues are the same. And to bring this out, I actually did this series called The Big Cats, The Inside Story, which I did last year in the lockdown, because I found that I suddenly woke up one day and I said, okay, if I'm not in the field, maybe all my friends are also not in the field. And so I reached out to my friends from 9 countries across the world to talk about big cat conservation across all of the continents. And we talked about, we talked to 35 experts, and these are people who are scientists, who are tourism experts, who are filmmakers, who are policy and decision makers, to talk about big cat conservation. And the issues were the same. The issues are the same everywhere. There are good people everywhere. There are greedy people everywhere. There are people who will give their lives for the protection of nature, there are people who will destroy nature without thinking twice about it. And this is what you learn when you travel. So that was, basically. One of the most important things is to find the right mentor. If you work with someone who is insecure about their own capabilities and they resent your capabilities, then they end up destroying you. So when you go out there and you go into the world, please make sure that you go out to work under people who you can look up to and respect. Don't go by what people say. Don't go by what you hear. Do your own research and figure it out. I've had years of persecution because a group of people decided to malign me. And that was something that changed my life. Okay. And when I left India and went to work with Professor David MacDonald in Oxford, I realized just how big the difference was. And I think that's one of the biggest takeaways that I can give people. The other takeaway is, you should never compromise on your own principles and ethics. Okay? You should be true to yourself, to your beliefs. If you are a scientist, you need to be true to your beliefs. And never worry about asking a question. It's only people who ask questions that go out and find the answers. If you don't ask the question, you'll never look for the answers. Please ask the question. Never be afraid to ask the question. The field of wildlife conservation research or wildlife conservation photography are not fields where you earn a lot of money easily. So my first suggestion to the young people who want to enter the field is make sure you have an alternate source of income, at least in the initial years. There are very, very few of us who are fortunate enough to be given the opportunity to work with people who will pay you a salary and let you get the experience. There must be just a handful, not even a handful, and it's very, very tough. Remember, this is not work. It can never be work. The day you think of this as work, you've already failed in this field. It has to be an all-encompassing passion. It is your passion, your ikigai, it's your reason for existence. There is no other thing that you want to do as much as you want to do this. And then and only then can you do anything worthwhile in this field. Unfortunately, the government, the private industry, the private sector just does not have place for people like us to gain regular employment. It just doesn't happen. So you need to remember that, and remember that you need to do this alongside everything else. You need to follow your passion in spite of everybody's words, you know, advising you to the contrary. You must never, never despair and give up. And every minute you get in the wild, making the photographs that you want to make, seeing the things that you're seeing, experiencing your experiences, that's the reward that you get. The money follows later. It's not the first thing that comes. I have many role models. The first, of course, is my father. He's influenced everything that I am, every the person that I am. My maternal grandmother, she was extraordinary and a very, very, very special person. My maternal grandfather, who taught me never to give up and to always look at the blessings and the positive side of every situation. He taught me that everything will pass, that there is always a sunrise to look forward to, and never despair. People like Dr. Jane Goodall, Diane Fossey, Dr. Chuck McDougall, Fateh Singh Rathor are people who worked in the field who really influenced what I do. I think books by people like Gerald Durrell, books by, you know, like Dr. Doolittle, the whole series, things that and all the animal classics that you grew up with, Wind in the Willows, Peter Rabbit, Charlotte's Web. These are all things that influenced me and made me the person that I am today. But also closer to home, a lot of the filmmakers like the Bedi brothers, like Ashish Chandola, like, you know, the whole team from BBC Wildlife and National Geographic, people that I met, the work that organizations like National Geographic do, those are things that really influenced me. And of course, people like Dr. Salim Ali, Mrs. Gandhi herself, because she was such a passionate wildlifer, Dr. J.C. Daniel, Dr. H.S. Pawar, Ranjit Singh Ji, Mankaner, his brother, Digvijay Singh, Daleep Mathai, Mr. P.K. Sen, all the great wildlife experts of India. I've been fortunate enough to grow up around them and to learn from them. And I started off, you know, very strong background of all of this. I'm always with animals. At home, I have 3 dogs. I have 2 St. Bernards and a Cocker Spaniel. I have 2 cats. I have bird feeders where the birds come to feed. I have a little thing for honeybees upstairs. I have little sparrow nests at the back. I have something or the other happening all the time. But I'm just, you know, I love design. I do a lot of work with design. I do a lot of photography, which is beyond wildlife photography. So I do portrait photography, I do landscape photography, I do food photography. I've recently been shooting chefs. I do interior design, I read, I garden, I cook. I used to play the guitar, which I've been doing less and less now, but I used to play the guitar. I learned Kuchipudi dance. I read anything and everything. I read all the time. I love movies, films, ballet, opera. I'm one of those people who never have free time. I'm never bored. I have interest in everything, anything. So yeah, I keep myself very busy. Okay, so I read a lot, and I often go back to search for things that are appropriate and describe what is in my photographs. And sometimes when I need to give a message, I turn to using the words that someone else has written to express what I'm feeling. So I did this post about the lion some time ago on World Lion Day. This is on my Instagram. And it says, I will show you what is strong. The lion is strong. When he raiseth himself up from his lair, when he shaketh his mane, when the voice of his roaring is heard, the cattle of the field fly and the wild beasts of the desert hide themselves, for he is terrible. John Keble, the creator. So sometimes when you're giving a message, for this was, for instance, on World Lion Day, you just use words spoken by somebody else because they express what you are feeling. So I often do that. And many of my posts on Instagram, you will find this. We're coming out of terrible times. In India, we have seen months of suffering and death and desperation that we have never seen before. And I hope we never see again. But through all of this, what's kept me going is to remember every morning when I wake up to count my blessings and to say, thank you, God, for everything that we have today. And God has given us so much. So I think what I really want to say to everyone is, remember, time is short. You're here for a very limited time on this earth. This planet has enough for us for our need, but it doesn't have enough for us for our greed. And it is our greed that is causing the problems that we're facing today, whether it's climate change, whether it's the spread of zoonotic diseases like COVID. We need to understand that we are but one of God's creatures on this planet. We don't control what is happening. And it is, this pandemic has shown us just how insignificant we are and how mortal we are. We need to understand and stick to our role in the web of life, to be limited to only the link that we're supposed to be. We can't live in isolation. We can't live without the rest of God's creatures. We can't live without fresh water. We can't breathe polluted air. So we need to learn to change our lives, to change each of us on one step every day to become better members of this ecosystem and this wonderful planet called Earth.
Dosto, ye thi famous conservation ecologist एंड वाइल्ड लाइफ फोटोग्राफर डॉक्टर लतिका नाथ की कहानी। ऐसी ही इंस्पायरिंग स्टोरीज रोजाना सुनने के लिए चैनल को सब्सक्राइब करें और बेल आइकन जरूर दबाएं। और अगर आज की ये कहानी आपको पसंद आई है तो इसे लाइक, कमेंट और शेयर जरूर करें। दोस्तों, आपके पास भी मौका है अपनी कहानी हर शख्स तक पहुँचाने का, तो जल्दी से आप भी साझा करें अपनी कहानी हमारे साथ, क्योंकि कहानियाँ ही बदलती हैं सोच, पैदा करती हैं नया जुनून और ले आती हैं हर एक की जिंदगी में उम्मीद की एक नई किरण। तो जल्दी से सुना दीजिए आप भी अपनी कहानी। Let's inspire together. We can, India can. अगर साथ मिलकर प्रयास करेंगे तो बहुत कुछ संभव है। तो आप भी नई नई कहानियां सुनने के लिए इस मुहिम में हमारे साथ जुड़िए। फिलहाल वक्त हो चला है आप सभी से इजाजत लेने का, लेकिन बहुत जल्द फिर मिलेंगे आपसे एक और नई कहानी के साथ। तब तक के लिए आप बने रहिए हमारे साथ और देखते रहिए दिलचस्प कहानियां। नमस्कार।